Dr. Jon Makar, who has traveled here from Ottawa today from the National Research Council.
我现在介绍乔伊马可尔博士，他今天是从那个Ottawa，就是坐飞机特别赶过来。
Yeah, Dr. Makar has been working on the magnesium oxide cement for a while, and he is going to tell us about the code acceptance in Canada and some more about his research on magnesium oxide cements.
Makar 博士已经就是为这个玻美板测试了一段时间，然后今天呢，他会给你们介绍一下，就是说这个玻美板如何符合加拿大的建筑规范的要求，然后还有一些什么你们可以做的。
So without further ado, Dr. Jon Makar.
Thank you for the introduction and the invitation to appear here. I will be providing an overview of how Canada's building regulatory system works and how companies can gain access to Canadian construction markets. My organization, the National Research Council Canada, or NRC, is a Canadian federal government body that is an integral part of the regulatory system across the country.
谢谢Peter对我的介绍和被邀请在这里给大家演讲。在这演讲里头呢，我会介绍加拿大建筑监管体系如何运作，建筑建材公司怎么样能够获得批准进入加拿大的这个市场。然后，他介绍他的工作单位叫加拿大国家研究委员会，是属于加拿大联邦政府的一个机构，也是建筑监管体系的一个组成部分。
I will also be talking about specific issues related to the evaluation of magnesium oxychloride hydrate or MGO products for compliance with Canada's National Building Code. My goal for this talk is to help you understand how construction products are qualified for use in Canada and what obstacles need to be overcome to introduce magnesium oxychloride boards to Canada on a broad basis.
然后呢，他会给大家讲一下，就是这里是怎么如何评价这个就是产品的，特别是对玻美板的产品，怎样呢才能够使这个产品符合这个国家建筑规范。这次演讲的目的呢，是帮助你们了解什么样的建筑产品可以有资格进入加拿大，或者很笼统的介绍一下，就是玻美板在现有的玻美板有些什么障碍要克服。
I will start by providing some background on NRC for those not familiar with it. Next will be an overview of the Canadian building regulatory system. This will be followed by discussion of the role of Canadian Construction Materials Centre, or CCMC, in the regulatory system. CCMC is part of NRC's construction portfolio and plays a key role in helping construction product suppliers in gaining access to Canadian markets.
首先呢，他会谈一下什么是加拿大国家研究委员会，因为就是让你们就是了解他们那个背景。然后呢，他就会谈论一下加拿大的监管系统，特别是谈论加拿大建材中心 CCMC， 它的在监管系统中起的什么作用。这个 CCMC 是 NRC 的一部分，然后呢，在这个引进建筑产品到加拿大市场呢，是起了关键的作用。
A discussion of current NRC experience with magnesium oxychloride hydrate products will follow. My presentation will conclude with a review of key quality control issues that may prevent acceptance of these products by CCMC.
然后呢，他会讨论一下，就是目前 NRC 对那个玻璃板产品的那个经验和测试的那个一些结果。然后最后呢，他会给大家回顾一下什么会阻碍那个 CCMC 接受玻美板的质量问题。
There will be a summary at the end of each section and an opportunity to ask questions at the end of the talk.
在每一个演讲的部分，他会做一个小小的那个总结，然后呢，给大家的机会去提出问题。
Let's start with the National Research Council Canada.
现在我先开始介绍加拿大国国家研究委员会。
NRC is Canada's premier research and technology organization. It is a federal government organization and is similar to organizations in other countries such as NIST in the United States, VTT in Finland, or CSTB in France.
NRC is Canada's first technology organization. It is a federal government organization and is similar to organizations in other countries such as NIST in the United States, VTT,和法国的 CSTB 一样的部门，类似的机构。
NRC's mandate is to conduct research and to develop technology for the benefits of Canadians, as indicated by its vision and mission statements.
NRC 的使命是为加拿大人的利益进行研究和开发技术。
So.Innovation takes place in a complex environment. Many different organizations produce fundamental research. Many other organizations can use that research to produce new products or services. NRC acts as a bridge between the two, moving discoveries from fundamental research to higher level or closer to market technology levels.
他说每一个新的产品都会发生在一些不同的行业或者那个复杂的环境中。所以呢，有很多不同的组织机构呢，就会进行各种的基础的研究。另外呢，还有许多公司的机构呢，就会利用这种研究成果生产新产品，或者提供新的服务。NRC 呢，就是充当这两者的桥梁，从基础那个研究到市场的那个技术水平。
NRC's roles include bridging the void in the innovation ecosystem.Providing a mission-driven channel for federal investment in R&D, developing collaboration across the ecosystem, and doing so effectively and efficiently.
NRC 的作用包括有就是桥接填饱创新生态系统的空白，提供一个研制发展的途径，为联邦投资做研究和开发，创造开发合作的机会。确保高效率和的实用性。
NRC has both research centers in red and industrial technology advisors in yellow located across Canada. In 2014, NRC's budget was approximately $900 million with about 3,550 employees.
NRC 在全国各地都有研究中心，红色的就是那个研究中心的那些地点，然后工业技术顾问中心，黄色的就是那些地点，然后呢，在2014年 ，NRC 的预算呢达到了9亿加元，现在呢拥有3,550名员工，是一个很大的机构。
NRC's business lines include strategic research and development, management of national science infrastructure, technical services, and the Industrial Research Assistance Plan, or IRAP. Evaluation of construction products are considered a technical service. IRAP provides research funding assistance for small to medium enterprises, which are companies that have less than 500 employees.
NRC 的业务呢是包括战略研究发展、国家科技基础设施的建设和技术服务管理，扶持工业研究计划，或者是叫工业研究计划项目 IRAP， 其中呢建筑产品包括了其中的建筑产品的评估是属于技术服务之一，那么这个 IRAP 呢就是会提供那个研究资金去扶持少于500。名员工的中小型企业。
NRC is divided into three research divisions with different roles. Emerging Technologies manages the national science infrastructure, such as radio telescopes, and does research on new and disruptive technologies.
NRC 呢就分成三个部门，一个呢是新兴的技术部门，它是管理国家科技基础设施和研究新的突破性的技术，比如说那个云色电网电网远近技术，这种高精端的技术。
Life sciences develops technologies based on biological principles to improve Canadian quality of life, including work on crops, medical technologies, and other biological technologies.
第二个部门是生物科学部门，基于生物的原理，提高加拿大人的生活质量，包括农作物、医疗技术和其他生物技术。
Engineering applies research and technology to solve problems in a variety of industrial sectors.
最后一个是工程部门，它是应用技术研究成果解决各种工业部门的问题。
So, the engineering division contains NRC's construction-related activities as well as aerospace, surface transportation, resource, and marine-related research.
这个工程部门呢，就包括各种与建筑施工有关的航空，还有航空航天、地面运输、资源和海洋有关的研究。
So, NRC construction provides solutions to improve building and infrastructure performance, accelerate technology commercialization, and reduce compliance work.Work on construction materials such as magnesium oxyhydrate boards falls into all three areas.
So, NRC 建筑工程部门为提高建筑和基础设施的性能，加快技术商业化，降低符合规范成本，提供解决方案。关于建筑材料，比如说玻璃板，就和以上这三个部分有关。
NRC construction competencies include the areas of building envelope and materials, civil engineering and infrastructure, intelligent building operations, fire safety, building regulations, and technical services such as testing. Our expertise in building materials and building regulations is important for the introduction of new materials and products to the Canadian market. Fire safety is also important for some magnesium oxychloride hydrate product applications.
NRC 建筑部门和建筑施工有关的那些，就是包括了建筑维护结构和材料、土木工程和技术设施、建筑智能化操作和消防安全、建筑法规以及技术服务，比如各种的测试等领域。我们在建筑材料和建筑法规的专长，以及引进新进的材料产品到加拿大市场方面起到很大的作用，同时消防安全也是对玻璃板应用特别重要。
In terms of building envelope materials, this work includes improving envelope and acoustic performance, building in physics, the evaluation and de-risking of new technologies.And the performance of compliance assessments on building products and guiding commercialization of those products through the Canadian Construction Materials Center, CCMC.
建筑维护结构和材料的业务呢，就包括改善建筑构造、声学性能和与建筑物理有关的方面的。通过加拿大建材中心 CCMC 的评估。排除应用新技术的风险，检核那个建筑产品的性能和指导产品的商业化。
The second activity, de-risking new building materials and systems, is also very important for the introduction of new construction products in the Canadian market. New building materials and products are often considered too risky for use by construction industry practitioners, such as engineers and architects, and by building owners.NRC helps to lower the risk of adoption through research as well as the CCMC evaluation process.
建筑工程部门第二个重要的业务是为加拿大市场引进新的建筑产品。建筑行业的从业者，比如说用户、施工部门、建筑师、设计师，他们一般都不愿意用新的产品，因为风险太大。NRC 呢，就是通过研究和 CCMC 的评估， 帮助他们减少使用新材料的风险。
Fire safety evaluates and improves on the performance of construction assemblies as well as developing new technologies for fire suppression and investigating the behavior of smoke and human occupants during a fire. Evaluation of magnesium oxychloride hydrate products to demonstrate improved fire performance over traditional approaches can be done by our labs using furnaces as well as equipment that can test small-scale samples through floor or wall assemblies to full houses and larger.
消防安全业务是评估和改善建筑整体和组件的性能，开发灭火的新技术和调查在火灾中烟雾扩散的趋势和民众的行为，也是建筑工程部门的一个业务。评估和显示玻璃板比传统产品有更好的防火性能，可以用各种的实验方法测试从一个很小的样本到整个地板或者墙壁的组件，甚至整个房子来完成。
NSC manages Canada's National Building Code System. More details on how this works will be presented in the next section of the presentation.
加拿大研究管理委员会负责管理加拿大国家建筑规范体系，对这个功能如何运作下一节会更详细的谈。
In summary, NRC Construction is part of a large world-class research and technology organization.
现在他就做一个小的总结，他说那个NRC 是建筑工程部门，是一个很大的世界级的技术研究部门。
NRC is part of Canada's federal government, reporting to the Minister of Industry.
他是属于加拿大联邦政府的一部分，直接接受部长的就是工业部部长的领导。
NRC Construction conducts strategic construction-related research and development for companies, other government departments, and other levels of government.
NRC 的建筑工程部门进行战略性和与建筑相关的研究，为企业、低级的政府部门和其他政府的服务。
It manages the National Building Code System on behalf of the provinces and territories.
它代表省和地区管理国家建筑规范系统。
It evaluates new building products such as those made with magnesium oxychloride hydrates for National Building Code compliance.
它评估新型产品，比如说玻璃板，是否符合国家建筑规范。
Do you want to ask them?
Yeah, I think it's
good. 看你们有没有问题，在这一部分。
Any questions before we move on to the next section?
No. Good.
All right, so let's talk about the Canada's building regulatory system. This will be an overview.
现在就是概述一下加拿大的建筑监管体系。
The regulatory environment in Canada is fairly complex. This slide shows the high-level connections between different government activities. A later slide will show how other parties fit into the system.
加拿大的监管层次网络是很复杂的。这张幻灯片呢，显示了高层次的和不同层面的政府活动之间的联系。随后呢会有其他的幻灯片展示一下还有不同等级的那个在网络里头的运作。
Under Canada's constitution, the provinces and territories have legal authority to regulate building construction. On the one hand, they delegate authority to municipalities in the form of the municipal building code officials to regulate local building activity. On the other hand, they have authorized NRC to run the national building code system on their behalf.NRC also operates CCMC under a mandate from the provinces and territories.
根据加拿大的宪法，各省和地区拥有法定权利来规范建筑施工和建筑材料。在一方面呢，他们把权利下放到各的省市，由市政建设法官来规范他们的 当地的建设活动，但是在另一方面呢，他又授权 NRC 代表国家法宪法运作国家建设规范，由另外 NRC 呢受各省和地区的授权经营加拿大建材中心 CCMC。
NRC manages and publishes the National Building Code, Fire Code, Plumbing Code, and Energy Code. These codes are model codes, with new versions of the codes coming out every 5 years. A new version of the National Building Code is due out later this year.
NRC 管理和发布国家建筑、消防、给排水和能源规范。这些规范呢，每五年更新一次。新的版本呢，会在今年晚一点时候就发行。
The provinces put the legislation in place to adapt the national model codes to their needs. The municipal building officials then decide whether particular construction projects meet the requirements of the provincial building code or whether changes are needed to them before they can go ahead.
国家规范是一个就是国家的一个标准。然后呢，每一个省和地区呢，他就先会拿到这些国家规范，然后呢，根据他们当地的不同需要来修改。
CCMC evaluates construction products and provides definitive opinions as to whether the products comply with the National Building Code. The municipal building officials use the CCMC opinions to decide whether or not to allow construction products to be used in their municipality.
加拿大建材中心评估建筑产品和对各类产品是否符合规范，给国家规范提供明确的意见。然后市政的建设官员呢，会根据这个意见决定那些产品可以允许在他们省和地区里头使用。
As you can see, the municipal officials represent the front line of the regulatory system and have the final decision on the use of construction products.
所以呢，就是各省市的市政官员就处于监管体系的第一线，对建筑产品使用呢有最终的决定权。
So just to reiterate some key points about the NRC's role in building regulation. NRC manages the National Building Code system on behalf of the provinces and territories. National Building Code is a model code. The provinces and territories may modify and put into legislation. The goal of the building code system is to ensure the safety of the building's occupants. And then finally, new editions of the National Building Code are issued on a 5-year cycle.
在这里呢，就我重新关于 NRC 在建筑规划系统的那个关键作用。第一是代表省和地区负责管理国家建筑规范系统。国家规范只是一个标准的规范，各省和地区可以修改和建立自己的规范。建筑规范的目的是确保建筑物内居住者的安全。国家规范的版本每五年更新一次。到了幻灯片19，就是。
As mentioned earlier.Municipal officials are the ones who approve building projects, including the materials used in the project. The local municipal building officials in each community have the final say on whether a project is approved in use of for use in their municipality.
正如刚才所说的，市政官员在审批建设项目之中，包括在项目里头使用的材料和产品，当地的那个建设官员在他们的省和地区市里头对建筑产品是否批准使用有最终的决定权。
There are significant differences between the United States approach to building codes and the Canadian one.
美国和加拿大的建筑规范有很显著的差异。
In the United States, structural issues are dealt with on an empirical basis.For example, a product might pass the code requirements if 3 tests of the product are all passes.
在美国，比如说结构上的问题是基于他们的经验， 这个基础上处理的。比如说一个产品，如果它通过三项那个测试，那么这个产品就可以通过规范。
In Canada, limit states engineering and reliability methods are used for structural design. The expected distribution of product properties must be determined, and the fifth percentile result of those properties found. The latter value is then used for design calculations.
在加拿大呢，是使用工程上极限状态的设计和可靠性的方法来决定的结构设计。必须知道产品的性能分布范围，找出低限的5%的数值，然后用这个数值来进行设计计算。晚一点呢，他会给大家讲一个计算的例子。
An example of how this works will be provided later in this talk.
晚一点他就会讲一下这个例子。
In addition, durability issues are a part of reliability and must be considered in evaluating construction products in Canada.In the United States, whether or not durability is considered depends on the individual standard that applies to that product.
此外呢，耐久性问题是产品可靠性内在的组成部分。在加拿大呢，建筑产品评估中必须考虑这个因素。而在美国呢，它就是耐久性是按个别的产品以个别的标准来考虑。
Some construction materials are written into the National Building Code. Others are not mentioned and therefore are considered innovative.
一些建筑材料呢已经列入国家建筑规范，其他呢就没有。没有列在规范里头的材料都被认为新型建筑材料。
The time the product has been on the market is not considered relevant to whether or not it is innovative for the purposes of the code.For example, PVC siding has been available for decades, but is still considered innovative since it isn't explicitly mentioned in the National Building Code.
产品在市场上用了多长时间，并不作为衡量是否新型材料的那个标准。比如说，聚氯越烯那个 PVC 外墙挂板已经用了几十年了，但是还是仍然被认为新型材料，因为它没有。明确的在那个国家建筑规范里头提及。
Some innovative materials such as PVC are covered by a relevant standard. Others are not covered by standard bodies such as the Canadian Standards Association, American Society for Testing Materials, or American National Standards Institute.
有些新型材料，比如说 PVC 呢，它可能是通过了一些相关的标准。但是还有其他材料呢，就根本没通过加拿大，比如说加拿大标准协会 CSA， 美国试验和材料协会 ASTM， 或者是美国国家标准协会 ANSI 的相关标准。
In some cases, the existing standards do not cover the full ranges of issues relevant to the National Building Code.
尽管这些材料通过了一些相关的标准，但是就是个别的标准。不能全部覆盖国家规范的要求范围。
There are two routes to having building officials approve the use of innovative building materials in Canada.
有两种途径可以使建筑官员批准使用新型的建筑材料。
A proponent, the person who wants the material to be used, can either present the official with documents stamped by a professional engineer.That certify the product or products in a project meet National Building Code requirements.
用户或者是供应商，他们想用这种新的材料的话，其中一种方法就是给那个建筑官员出示有资格的专业工程师加盖的认证产品文件，认定这个产品在特定的项目中能够达到。国家建筑规范的要求。
Or they can present the official with a CCMC report or listing that states the product itself meets the requirements of the National Building Code.
第二个方法就是给建筑官员出示一份 CCMC 的报告或者是表格，证明这个产品是符合 MBCC 国家建筑规范的要求。
In either case, the building official decides whether to accept the product based on the information that's been provided.
就是其中一种那个地方官员就可以啊，根据这个提高的文件来决定是否接受新型的这种新型的建筑材料。
CCMC makes it easier to gain market acceptance of innovative construction products for several reasons.
CCMC 加拿大建材中心比其他方法更为容易为那个新型材料获得市场认可，有以下几种原因。
First, there are about 8,000 municipal building officials across Canada, and many more construction projects are undertaken each year. Needing to demonstrate compliance with the National Building Code for each project is expensive and time-consuming. It's much cheaper to go through CCMC.
首先，加拿大各地有8000多市政建设政府官员和每年都有很多的建设项目。你们如果是每一个产品都要逐一证明符合 MBCC 的要求，既昂贵又费时。但是经过 CCMC 呢，就很便宜。
Second, some major municipalities will only accept products with CCMC evaluations.
第二，一些主要的城市只接受 CCMC 认可的产品。
Third, a CCMC technical guide and successful evaluation is often the first step towards the development of a CSA standard for a product and eventually inclusion in the National Building Code.
第三个，CCMC 那个技术指导和成功评估通常是朝向达到加拿大标准协会 CSA 的标准的第一步，然后呢，才能达到国家规范的要求。
Summarizing this overview of Canada's building regulatory system.
总结 ，OK， 现在是总结一下，就是对加拿大建筑建管体系的那个概述。
Provinces and territories hold legal authority over the building codes and delegate decision-making authority to municipal building officials.
各省和地区具有建筑规范和委托决策权。给予市政建设官员的法律权威。
NRC manages the National Building Code system on behalf of the provinces. CCMC evaluates construction products for National Building Code compliance again on behalf of the provinces.
NRC 代表各省份管理国家建设规范体系。加拿大建材中心 CCMC 代表各省份评估建设产品是否符合国家规范。
CCMC provides a cost-effective route for demonstrating code compliance to municipal building officials.
加拿大建材中心 CCMC 提供了具有成本效益的途径，给市政建设官员证明产品符合规范要求。
Pause for questions.
Yeah. 看你们有没有问题对这个监管体系方面的概述。
那个，我想问一下 ，CCMC 是通过什么手段来？判断一个新型的材料是不是符合这个建筑规范？
这个下面他会讲。
下面有啊。
The question is how CCMC evaluate product. I said you will say it next.
Yes.
Any question? 还有其他问题吗？好。
All right. So I've talked about CCMC in the previous section of this presentation. I'm now going to cover how it works in more detail, including the types of services CCMC offers, how it evaluates construction products, and what happens when the evaluation is done.
现在我就详细的讲一下 CCMC 是怎么工作的，然后包括它提供了什么服务类型，如何评估建筑产品。然后评估以后会有些什么结果。
CCMC's role is mandated by the provinces, but it exists to help construction innovations get to market. Innovative products often get stopped by the regulatory framework. CCMC gets products through the process.
CCMC 的角色是由各省授权的，但是它的存在呢，是为了新型建筑材料进入市场。这种新型的材料经常会被监管部门限制使用，然后 CCMC 呢就帮助产品通过审批得以使用。
The actual system of assessing compliance of construction products is complex. I won't try to go into all the details, but I've included the flowchart to show just how complex it is.
从这个流程图里面可以看到，就是 CCMC 那个操作那个系统是很比较复杂的。
CCMC helps to minimize the contacts between product suppliers and other parts of the system. Unless they are trying to develop a product standard, most manufacturers will only deal with CCMC, the independent testing organizations, their own clients, and possibly municipal building officials.
CCMC 呢就有助于最大的限度减少产品供应商和系统的其他部分之间的接触，除非他们想建立一个产品的标准。大多数的厂商和供应商只愿意和 CCMC 联系，因为它是一个独立的测试结构，而他们的客户呢，也有可能是市政建设的官员。
CCMC essentially provides one service. It gives authoritative opinions as to whether a product meets the minimum requirements of the National Building Code.
说到底CCMC 实际上提供的就是只有唯一的一个服务，给予一个关于产品是否符合国家规范的最低要求权威意见。
Successful evaluations mean that the products are considered either acceptable or alternative solutions.
成功评估的结果意味着这个产品要么有可以接受。或者是另类的结论。
Acceptable solutions are ones that are actually covered by the National Building Code. Alternative solutions meet the same objectives and functions of an acceptable solution.
可接受，也就是说这个产品是完全的通过了国家规范的要求。另类呢，就是说要用一个可接受的解决方法去满足同样的功能和目标。最终达到这个国家规范的要求。
Most innovative products are alternative solutions.
大部分的新型产品是用另类的方法来代替解决的。
As mentioned earlier, CCMC produces two types of products, listings and reports. They have similar appearance but contain different information and are labeled accordingly.
CCMC 呢，它最终会给出两个类型的结果，一个就是清单，一个是报告。它们呢都有相似的外观，但是呢包含不同的信息，并有相应的标记。
Listings cover standardized products. They include, for example, some types of insulation, various siding products.Roofing membranes and windows.
清单呢，它覆盖了就是已经是有公认的标准的产品，比如说一些保温的材料啊，各种壁板的项目啊，还有屋顶用的薄膜和窗户。
Reports cover products where there is no existing standard. Other types of insulation fall into this category.
报告呢是包括没有列入现有的标准的产品，比如说保温材料里头有一些新型的材料就属于要需要有报告。
An example of a structural product that would need a report is structural insulated panels, where the panel is composed of two facer panels and an insulating foam core that is used to replace standard frame wood frame construction.
这里有一个结构产品需要检验报告来证明的例子，这是一个就从那个这是一个标准的结构隔热板，就是由两块面板和决然的泡沫材料组成的，它是用来代替标准的木结构。
This technology is actually in the first stages of the CCM process right now.
这种材料现在呢还在 CCMC 的检验过程中，只是第一阶段。
The CCMC process for producing a report on an innovative product requires several steps. First, the proponent submits an application to CCMC. Then, a CCMC evaluation officer reviews the application to make sure the product is eligible for inclusion in the CCMC process.
完成 CCMC 的一个新型产品的检验报告需要几个步骤。首先要申请，向 CCMC 提出申请。然后呢 ，CCMC 要审查那个申请材料，确保这个产品是有资格被接受检验的。
If it is eligible, then the evaluation officer examines the information available on the product and determines a plan for its evaluation that takes a number of different factors into consideration.
如果这个产品是有资格被检验，评估职员就会检验产品上的那个信息，然后确定一个包括了考虑了许多不同的因素的评估方案。
The evaluation officer identifies an independent expert who can write a technical guide that dictates how the product should be tested during the evaluation. An important factor is benchmarking the innovative product against an equivalent product and system that is already covered by the National Building Code. As an example, magnesium oxyhydrate boards might be benchmarked against gypsum wallboard if the intended application was interior wall sheathing.
CCMC 的评估员是被认可的独立专业人员，能够确定技术指南，在评估过程中指导产品的测试。一个最重要的因素就是如何确定新产品与已经列入国家建筑规范中同类产品和系统相比的基准点。比如说玻美板相对石膏板来讲，基准点可能可以用室内的内墙板来开始。
Developing a technical guide may require research to determine how to test the product.
自动那个既定技术指南可能需要研究，以确定如何对产品进行测试。
An independent third party then tests the product according to the technical guide. CCMC may specify that the test be done by the expert who wrote the technical guide.
这里说的可能会要用独立的第三方根据技术指南进行产品测试。CCMC 可以指定该测试由制定技术指南的专家来完成。也许说，就是说，他 CCMC 可以委托一个第三方的那个实验室来写这个指南，然后经过他们批准，然后呢 ，CCMC 也许就会让他们做吧，就这样。
The evaluation officer then examines the results of the tests and the conclusions of the testing organization about the product.
然后 CCMC 的评估员就会检查那个测试结果，最后呢为那个测试的检测机构递出产品性能的结论。
If the examination is successful, a CCMC report will be issued stating CCMC's opinion that it complies with the National Building Code and providing supporting data.
如果这个产品检验成功 ，CCMC 呢就会以 CCMC 的名义，做出报告，然后说明这个产品符合MBCC 的要求，并提高数据去支持这个结论。
CCMC uses a wide variety of experts to produce technical guides, including NRC researchers, university researchers, consultant specialists, and other research organizations. This
这个第三方的那个研究机构 CCMC 会用的，会包括比如说 NRC， 还有大学，还有一些顾问，还有其他研究机构的专家。
This is where I come into the CCMC process. I'm an NRC researcher who produces technical guides for CCMC and test products for National Building Code compliance. Since I have a background in cementitious materials, I've been tasked with developing the technical guides for magnesium oxychloride hydrate products that are submitted to CCMC.
他说这是对他个人来讲，就是说他这是他介入那个 CCMC 程序的一个原因。他是 NRC 的研究员，然后呢，他现在是为 CCMC 制定技术指南、测试产品，以达到国家建筑规范的要求。因为他有水泥材料知识的背景，所以他一直为 CCMC 负责制定检验玻煤板的技术指南。
Once written, a technical guide contains mandatory testing and performance requirements to provide the information needed to show National Building Code compliance.
技术指南包括强制性的性能要求检测，提供和显示如何符合MBCC 要求的方法方式。这些技术和范围可能包括从实验室测试、设计和模拟，甚至到现场使用的要求。
These may range from laboratory testing through design and modeling issues to field use requirements.
这些刚才说了，就是包括从实验室测试、设置和到现场使用的要求。
The technical guide may also contain other information on testing for health and safety requirements, testing required by the proponent for non-building code issues, and other CCMC requirements.
技术指南也可能包括在健康和安全要求方面的测试，非建筑规范上面的问题和其他 CCMC 要求的测试。
Proponents may ask for additional testing if their product has novel properties that address a need that is not covered by the National Building Code. Including this type of testing in the technical guide means that a recognized independent third party will test and confirm those properties.
如果一些产品是有新的性能，不包括在国家规范的内，用户或者供应商呢，可以要求额外的测试，包括这些类型的测试在技术指南里，意味着一个被公认独立的第三方将测试结果和确认这些属性。
The technical guide may also require additional documentation in terms of installation manuals, quality assurance protocols, and product labeling.Quality assurance is an essential part of obtaining and keeping a CCMC evaluation.
技术指南可能还包括一些额外的文件，比如说安装手册、质量保证协议和产品标签。产品保证是获得和保持 CCMC 评级的重要的组成部分。
Test requirements include.Sampling by independent third parties as required by the technical guide, and testing by accredited independent third party laboratories located in Canada or the United States.
测试要求包括根据那个技术指南的要求，由独立的第三方抽采样品，然后测试是由加拿大或者美国认可的独立的第三方实验室进行。
Some testing can be done in conjunction with developing the technical guide. As noted earlier, CCMC may require the first set of tests to be done by the technical guide developer.
一些测试可以以制定技术指南来相结合完成。比如说 ,CCMC 可能要求第一组的试验是由制定技术指南的作者来完成，或者机构。
After a successful evaluation, a CCMC report will be issued for the product. The report is valid for 3 years, providing the proponent of the product affirms each year that nothing has changed in its manufacture. After 3 years, a re-evaluation must take place.
在成功评估后 ,CCMC 为评估产品发表报告书。这个报告书有效期只有3年。产品提供者每年都要确认在生产上没有任何变化，3年后必须进行产品重新评估。
The extent of the re-evaluation depends on the product. Generally, less information is required at the first 3-year re-evaluation than at a subsequent one. A full re-evaluation will take place at least every 9 years.
这个产品的那个重新评估取决于产品的使用和所以第一轮的三年重新评估通常需要的信息呢就比第二轮第三轮呢重新评估要少一点他说最少每九年要有一个完整的重新评估的过程
Finally, CCMC reports are published online so that they can be readily accessible by the construction community.
最后 CCMC 的报告会发表在网上建筑界的同行都可以很容易的得到
Summarizing CCMC's role in the Canadian building regulatory system, CCMC operates on the behalf of Canadian provinces and territories.
Okay. 现在总结一下，就是加拿大建材中心 CCMC 在加拿大建筑监管体系的作用。CCMC 的操作是代表了加拿大各省和地区。
Standardized products are evaluated and given a CCMC listing.
标准化的产品会列入 CCMC 的表格里。
Innovative, non-standard products require the development of a technical guide.
新型的非标准产品需要制定技术指南。
Products are then tested according to the technical guide and the results evaluated by CCMC.
产品根据技术指南测试结果由 CCMC 评估
And a successful evaluation results in a CCMC report and eases market entry
成功的评估结果会由 CCMC 发表报告简化市场的批准进入
Questions?
有没有问题
没有通过这个 CCMC 认证的产品，可不可以找一些小型的工程做试验？
小型的工哦。
做试
验。
So the question is, if the product cannot pass CCMC testing, can they use small project and to do the I think it build a small project and for demonstration
yeah.
or something.
If a product doesn't pass CCMC testing, generally it would be difficult to use it in the construction market or to sell it. Often if a product has a problem with passing CCMC testingNRC or other researchers will help to resolve the issue. So the tests, the report gives direction, will give testing report will give direction on what needs to be fixed, and NRC can discuss how to fix it.
他说，你刚才说那个方法可能行不通，但是呢，在你们通，就是在做通过这个CCMC 的那个测试的当中，如果通不过的话 ，NRC 和 CCMC 它会找到原因，然后帮助你们，就是说解决，就是该怎么样通过，或者是提高你们的产品的质量，就是从这些方面来看。
So, I'd like to point out if I'm accurate, the building code doesn't actually require CCMC.But CCMC provides a high-level opinion of the suitability of the material.
Exactly.
So an independent professional engineer or architect can write a schedule that also approves the material specific for a project.
他说，国家的建筑规范其实是不需要CCMC 的意见来说你可以使用还是不可以使用但是 CCMC 的那个意见呢就是比较高层次然后呢就很多建筑师和设计那个
施工者他会根据他们的意见来使用你们的产品，但比如说单家独户那些小的工程，也许他不需要，他你们都可以，他们就会直接使用。
政府监管，也许监管比较大，
监管比较大，或者是对一些非可燃建筑，这个最主要。
The National Building Code covers both routes. You can go through CCMC, you can go through professionals for local projects. CCMC gives you broader coverage that lasts for a longer time. That's the biggest difference.
So as we mentioned,
He said that this product has two ways. 我认为可以达到这个要求，然后可以用在我这个工程上，只要他盖章，那么那个当地的政府说 OK， 你可以用。但CCMC 呢，就是比较大的范围的，只要他盖章，那么任何的地方他都可以用，你不用一个一个的找个那个有资格的那个工程师去盖章。
With the intent of the code, acceptable versus alternative, is it the intent of the code that the design professional can deem whether something could be benchmarked? It's unclear in the book.
What you'd be looking at is the professional, my understanding, I'm not a CCMC official, but my understanding of it is that the professional is certifying that the product is in compliance with the building code. The professional doesn't get to certify whether it's an acceptable solution or an alternative solution. Acceptable solutions are usually the ones that are actually in the building code itself, and alternative ones are everything else.
Well, you mentioned benchmarking against gypsum versus.
Yeah, but that's part of the CCMC evaluation process.
Right.
So when we do a technical guide, we would compare the product to the closest equivalent product that's already in the code. That's part of the yeah.
他们的讨论现在就是说 ，Peter 问就是说，那个盖章的那个工程师是不是一定要认可？他就说你这个现在他不太清楚，也不一定。那么那个Peter 就是说，比如说你说这个对比，刚才就说了，就是那个技术指南里头，他们想就是你们要有一个基准点，比如说玻璃板的基准点就是内墙板和这个石膏板来对比，那么这个是不是就是一般的工程师就可以做？他说他不太清楚，但是呢，对于 CCMC 的那个他们的过程呢，他们就是首先要拿到这个基准点，然后再从这个基准点来，那个扩展和对比，然后得到结果。
You mentioned one of the slides that CCMC only accepts test results from North American labs. If their Intertech is accepted,
okay, that's two different things. Okay, for the purposes of the evaluation.CCMC only accepts results from North American labs. For purpose of ongoing quality assurance, it needs to be an independent third party. So, but.
Peter 的问题说是，刚才有一个就是他讲一个问题，就是说他这些结果要测试，就是那些实验室一定要在北美。那么 Intertech 在中国会怎么样？他就是说，如果是要通过产品的那个标准的话，他认为是应该要在北美。但是你那个就是说要那个产品的保障的那些实验的话，你可能可以用你们自己的那个独立的或者实验室来做。
Just as an example in terms of other MGO boards that I've been involved with.The boards have been the ones that have been shipped over from the manufacturer. They've been, samples have been randomly selected from what's actually shipped because the testing has to be done on what you're intending to sell. And then the preliminary testing is done there. is done on those boards that have been actually delivered to Canada.
When they're in North America.
Once you get into the quality assurance issues, then obviously the closer you are to the plant, the better you are. And I don't think there's any restrictions on using quality assurance personnel in, for instance, China to do the quality assurance part.
So an Intertech lab in that case in Shanghai is deemed equal?
Should be deemed suitable for that purpose.
Mm-hmm. 就是说他特别强调一下，就是说在你保障产品质量的那个你们的需要的话，
那么在国内，比如说天翔就可以测。明白，这边的意思，因为那个天翔在正好在上海有一个实验室，所以教授的意思，如果这个实验室和北美的实验室是一个水平的话，是可以接受。不是，他就说你要，就是说，比如说现在他出你们出口的那个产品。 不知道你们现在有没有做测试，就是说你们出版出品是先做测试，抽样测试再出品呢，还是就直接出品？他是认为你要保障那个产品质量的话，你必须先测试抽样测试，你们认为可以了就可以出品。这样的那个实验的话就在国内做，但是就是说要做再说你可以在北美市场用的一个就是总的标准来讲的话。
John, actually, I think there's a question.
Does the CCMC report cover all types of construction in Part 3 and Part 9?
Yes. It's just it's a general report.
他就说他, Mike的那个, 问题就是和我, 你们拿到的第三本的那个标准里头所有的那个测试, 他说 CCMC 是不是全部覆盖了所有这些测试？比如说 Part 9 是可燃建筑的，和 Part 3 是就是第三部分的那个规范，是不是非可燃建筑的所有的那个标准？他说是全部包括，然后是综合的。The
difference is that there's more requirements for Part 3 in general, particularly around things like fire and acoustics, but other aspects as well. And so when you come into the evaluation process, you need to tell CCMC whether you intend to only sell your product for Part 9 use on single family homes, or whether you want to have it cover the full range of applications.
他说，然后呢，在你们做申请的时候，对一个产品。 比如说，不同的等级，你们要申请。比如说，我是只是做内墙板，或者是对，只是做可燃，放在可燃建筑里头的，那他就按在可燃建筑的那个产品来做测试。但是如果你说是我要做防火的，那他就要加那个防火的那些测试。
What accreditation standard is required of the labs, and who actually grants that?
It has to be a recognized laboratory. I don't think there's a specific accreditation body because there's more than one. But it has to be really, have to check with CCMC on the exact list, but there's a number of different laboratories which are qualified to do different tests and more than one accreditation standard.
Can I translate?
Yeah.
这个问题就是说是什么样的那个实验室才可以做实验，是不是一定要有认证的实验室？然后回答就是说，你一定要和 CCMC 先谈，就是说究竟他们承认不承认？现在没有，好像还没有什么就是专门的说这个可以，那个不可以。In
part, it depends on whether the laboratory can do the tests as well. A company like Intertech is accredited and would be an acceptable testing facility for most of the tests. There's some specific tests that very few laboratories can do, and there's a few unique tests that only one place can do.
So, but it is conceivable that Intertech China could actually be accredited to do even a CSA or a ULC test.
Sure.
Yeah. And it would be recognized.
Well, this comes back to the evaluation versus ongoing quality assurance. because for the evaluation purposes right now, they specify must be done in the United States and Canada.
Okay, so that's like in stone.
Yeah, that's, okay. That's part of the policy.
他就说，比如说那实验室，比如说 Intertech， 啊、现在是确认的，那么就大部分的都可以他们做。但是呢，如果是其他的实验室，他们有能力的话，也可以做。那么，刚才Ken 也提出了你刚才说的问题，就是说天翔在中国有机构，是不是他可以做？那还是我那个回答，就是说你要保障产品质量的话，他们可以做。但是你要做那个 CCMC 的报告的话，一定要拿到这里做。
I was to understand, but maybe I have it wrong, that the Canadian labs had to be accredited by FCC or the Standard Council of Canada.
They probably do. I'm not the expert on what qualifications they have to have. I know some of the people I've worked with, and I like, so I know no internet tech spin is qualified to do many of the tests, but what the specific qualification is right now, I'm not the best person to ask.
But you were talking about you can have like a university.
Oh, that's that. The university is a bit for the development of the technical guides, we can use universities to develop the technical guides. If there is a unique test that the university has developed for a particular product, which sometimes happens, then the university would probably be asked to test it. But normally universities aren't considered accredited testing bodies, so they wouldn't be asked to do the regular tests. There are exceptions. For instance, there's a professor at the University of New Brunswick who can do racking wall tests, and he's one of the few people who can do them, so he is often asked to do racking wall tests.
他这里还是说就是什么实验室可以做，那么这位先生就是说他认为是一定要公认的啊认可的才可以做，但是呢他就说他不是太就是对这里太了解，但我就问，那么在学校，刚才他说学校的那个实验室也可以做，他说学校的实验室呢，如果他有能力的，他一般特别是对独特的那个实验的话，一般他们可以写这个技术指南，然后如果他们是被认可或者可以的话，他们也可以做。他就举了一个例子，在一个大学。一个教授他是比较专家对那个我不太懂，就是好像是那个 rock 试验，就是那个 no I really don't
wall racking it's when you have a wall you have a load on the top and you're pushing it from the side to see what happens under wind conditions say
他就说就是有一个实验哈，比如说你建了一个墙，然后你上面放了一些重量，然后它就有一些很大的那个风力或者什么，就是打过去就这个呢就是那个教授是很有资格的，那么基本上他都很多人都找他做，就这样。
Do you consider magnesium oxide board to be a fiber reinforced cement panel or an innovative new material?
It would be an innovative new material. It's not explicitly mentioned in the National Building Code, therefore it's innovative and it has to be treated as such. And there's no existing standard, or at least North American accepted standard for it, so you get into the technical guide process rather than the listing process.
Peter's question is, he said that your plastic board is considered a standard material or a new material?他说是属于新型材料，一定要经过那个技术指南，然后写入报告里头。
Can you elaborate a little bit more on the difference between a listing and just an evaluation?
他 Ken 的那个问题就是说，他想你他详细的谈一下，就是这个清单表格和报告有什么不同。
A listing is available for standardized products and is basically says that the product complies with the standard and that CCMC has had it tested by an independent third party and confirms that, that it complies.
那么那个就是清单呢，它就是包括了就是那些标准的产品，然后那个 CCMC 它就是说这些产品是达到标准的，你们可以用。
It's the innovative non-standardized products that require the technical guide, and so the technical guide results in the report.
然后那个新型的材料呢，就是要做这个技术指南和测试设计。设计，然后完了以后，结果呢，它就放在报告里头。
And then the report lists the intended use of the product, which products it's similar to potentially. It gives the intended function of the product, and it gives the supporting information that CCMC used to say that it complies with the building code. So. You might have all the tests fell within a certain range of flexural strengths, for instance, would be listed in the report.
那么那个报告书呢，它因为是对新型建筑材料来讲的，所以呢，它就会比较详细，就是说这个产品就是一般是用在什么地方，在测试里头会有些什么失败，这些都会写在那个叫报告书里头。
What's the average time frame for the CCMC process?
I'm not sure I want to answer that.
那个问题就是说，那个 Mike 的问题说，多长时间，才能完成这个过程，就是 CCMC 的过程。9 years?
No, it's very not be the process. It depends on. But okay, two parts. There's the getting through the CCMC bureaucracy and getting the actual technical guide written up and the testing done. I can't talk about the first part because it's not my area of expertise. Perhaps a good thing, but.
You mean the.
The processing of the application is one part of the process, and that's something I can't talk about in terms of time. I can talk about the technical guide. And the
他说这个CCMC 的测试呢分成两部分，第一部分就是申请的那个程序，他说他不懂，所以他不会讲。
Let me finish the answer.
Okay.
In terms of the writing the technical guide and the doing the testing, depends very much on the initial evaluation of the product and how much is unknown about it. I can say probably for something like not all magnesium oxide MgO board applications, but many applications you're probably looking at less than a year to go from getting the technical guide started to having all the testing done. But
a year only?
Yeah, that's to get everything. That's not the framework around it, which may take longer, but in terms of
the technical guide.
Just the writing the technical guide and doing the evaluation.
他就说那个写这个技术指南，然后再初步评估你那个产品，一般就是一年时间，然后不包括你的测试，就是指南。
That depends very much on the application and what the unknowns are about the product. Something that's a variation on an existing product can be very quick. Something that's complex and there's a lot of missing information on it can take longer. The structural insulated panels project I mentioned earlier is going to take 3.25 years to write the technical guide because there's so little information available on how those panels really work.
You mean SIP?
You
mean the SIP?
Yeah, the SIP.
他说这个这个过程呢，还要看他们就是这个对产品的了解有多深。如果对那个产品或者是评估的产品那个比较快的话，那个技术指南就写得很快。 就刚才讲的那个结构隔热板，因为它可能包括两种材料，然后呢他们就是很新，就对这个知道的比较少。他说大概要用三年的时间才能完成这个技术指南。
SIPs have been around for a long time. I think they were first being used in the 1950s or 60s. There are big gaps in the available information on them, both in terms of structural performance and on durability. If you look at the ANSI standard for SIPs, there's a whole bunch of things that they say our standard does not cover. Those are all the things we have to cover.
Okay. 他刚才说的那个结构隔热板，他说其实他们已经在五六十年代就开始开用了，但是呢很多那个信息和知识他们就脱节了，所以他现在才来做了一个标准，他们就要把它收集了，然后才能重新做。
Just briefly for clarification on the question regarding standardization and innovative products.The standardized products are therefore listed in the NBCC, the National Building Code?
No, the products are in the National Building Code, which are usually the traditional products, like concrete, wood stud framing, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Products that aren't listed in the NBC, but are standardized would be things like PVC siding, or extruded polystyrene foam, insulation foam.There's a robust standard that's accepted, but it's not actually mentioned in the National Building Code.
的那个问题是说，他说这个 CCMC 的清单和这个国家规范里头的表格是不是就是可用产品的表格是不是一样？他说呢，不一样。国家规范里头的那个产品表格是包括了传统的产品。比如说混凝土啊、木材啊之类的这些东西 ，CCMC 的那个表格呢是包括了，就是那些不在国家安全就是也包括不在国家规范里头的产品，但是呢，通过他们的测试，就是说是通过了的，是标准性的，他们就放在那个表格里头。
You mentioned two successful outcomes of a report being whether it's deemed as acceptable or deemed as an alternative solution.
Yes.
I guess I'm wondering, you know, as an alternative solution, do you still have to have the verification of a professional?
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
All right.
Acceptable and alternative
Okay. Ken 的那个问题呢，就是说，他说你们那个通过CCMC 的那个。途径有两种，一个就是说你一测试所有都达到标准没问题，另外呢就是要用另类的方法，比如说你测试失败了，然后 NRC 或者其他的那个专业人员和 CCMC 和用户和厂商在一起研究，说我们用另外一个途径然后来达到。他说这种途径要不要认可，他说不用。
Acceptable and alternative areBuilding code language or national building code language, and it really refers to whether it's written right into the building code or whether it's something that is will do the same thing but is not written into the building code. That's the difference. One of the problems with the building code that specifies some materials is it can inhibit innovation.And so this structure was set up to provide a way to introduce new materials, new products, but make sure they have the same function.
他就说，他说不用就是认可的那个那些专家去或者是定或者是过程去定，是因为就是建筑规范呢。它有那个就是好处也有坏处，坏处就是说限制新型材料使用，然后呢他们就开了一个口，然后就说就是有那个 CCMC 或者是一些有专业可以盖章的一些工程师，他们就说通过那个测试就是认为可以用的新型产品他们就可以用。
Now,Municipal building officials always have the final say. So they can say, I don't care about your professional evaluation you've had done, or I don't care about CCMC, I just don't feel comfortable with this product and you can't use it?
It's unlikely.
It's unlikely, but it is possible.
他就说最后还是当地的那个规范官员说了算，他说就算是你有那个专业工程师盖了章，或者是 CCMC 有了报告，如果他觉得我还是不想用，那他就说不能用。不过呢 ，Ken say 说就说一般他们都会用。
want to ask more about the, you said that there are some other requirements like health requirements. I'm just wondering how CCMC might take steps to protect against materials that are potentially hazardous.
One of the things that will be a requirement for anything that's qualified as a magnesium oxide board will be XRD, X-ray diffraction analysis, and X-ray fluorescence analysis to look at both quality control, I'll get into that a little bit later, but also to look for hazardous materials.
Okay, Ken的那个问题就是说你那个就是说他说对那个就是比较有危害物质的一些材料 CCMD会有些什么规定或什么做法， 他就说下面呢他 就是下面他讲的那头也会更长。 Can you, I think you...
My question was answered, thank you.
Okay.
So do you still have more to present?
Yes, I do.
Oh, okay, well then I won't ask any more questions.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, yeah. Now okay. We're going into the MGO.
All right, okay.
然后继续,
刚才这个孙总谈到他是一直在为CCMC负责制定检测湖美平板的这个技术指南，那么现在他认为 有可能会影响湖美平板进入加拿大市场的主要问题在哪？下面就是开始。下面有啊。
哎 ，the question is about the detail, testing detail or result of the.
Yeah. Okay.
So you are.
All right. So I'll go on with the section that's actually on MGO boards.
现在他就开始讲，就是说特别关于那个玻美板的那个部分。And
I'll specifically be talking about NRC's experience with this type of product to date.
他会谈论就是说那个 NRC 现在对玻美板的现在就是到目前为止的经验，测试经验。